Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from Anna Mateo and John Russell. Later, Bryan Lynn presents this week's technology report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Jill Robbins and Andrew Smith. But first,
the largest bug to ever live was about 2.6 meters long and had many legs. However, the look and shape of its head remained a mystery until now. The fossils of these creatures are often headless shells. When bugs drop their shells, a process called shedding, they move out of the head opening, leaving behind their exoskeleton, but very little of the head. Recently, scientists solved that mystery by recreating the creature's head. They were able to do this after studying complete and well-kept fossils of younger bugs. The researchers published the new findings on October 10th in Science Advances. What did the heads look like? The huge bug's head was round, with two short bell-shaped antennae. It had two eyes that stuck out like crab's eyes. Its mouth was fairly small and made for eating leaves and the outer covering of trees. Its name is Arthroplera. This bug belonged to a group of crabs, spiders, and insects called arthropods. But the bug was much, much bigger. It could grow as big as 2.6 meters and weigh as much as 50 kilograms. The co-writer of the study is Michael Leitier. He is a paleobiologist at the University Claude Bernard Lyon in Villeurbanne, France. He said, "We discovered that it had the body of a millipede, but head of a centipede." This large Arthroplera may have been the biggest bug to ever live, although not all scientists agree. Some say Arthroplera may be a close second to an extinct giant sea scorpion. Researchers in Europe and North America have been collecting pieces and footprints of the huge bugs since the late 1800s. We have been wanting to see what the head of this animal looked like for a really long time, said James Lamsdell. He is a paleobiologist at West Virginia University and was not involved in the study. To produce a model of the head, researchers first used CT scans to study full-body fossils of younger bugs. These fossils were found in a French coal field in the 1980s. This method permitted researchers to look closely for hidden details, like bits of the head, still in the rock, without hurting the fossil, Lamsdell said. The fossils are easily broken. He added that when you dig in the rock to remove the fossil, you do not know what part of the fossil may have been lost or damaged. The fossils of younger bugs only measured about 6 centimeters. And it is possible they were a kind of Arthroplera that did not grow to a really large size. but still, researchers said, they are close enough to the huge Arthroplera to provide a picture of what adults looked like when they were alive 300 million years ago. I'm Ana Mateo.
Scientists in Brazil recently announced the discovery of one of the world's oldest reptile remains. They say the bones, dating back to around 237 million years ago, may help explain the rise of the dinosaurs. The four-legged reptile species is called Gondwanax paraisensis, researchers recently announced in a statement. The animal is believed to have been near the size of a small dog with a long tail. The small reptile would have lived in the Triassic period on land which is today southern Brazil. During this period, from 252 million to 201 million years ago, the world was much hotter. The fossil was identified as a new psilosaurid, a group of reptiles believed to have died off in a mass extinction event. Experts have debated whether psilosaurids were true dinosaurs or if they came before dinosaurs. Understanding the characteristics of these precursors could shed light on what was crucial for the dinosaurs' evolutionary success, a statement from the researcher said. In 2014, Pedro Lucas Porcela Aurelio, a medical doctor, found the remains in a piece of rock in the town of Paraíso do Sul. The town sits in Brazil's southernmost state of Rio Grande do Sul. The Gondwanax paraisensis fossil comes from a time when dinosaurs, as well as mammals, crocodiles, turtles, and frogs, first appeared. Aurelio gave the remains to a local university in 2021, beginning 3 years of research. Being the first human to touch something from 237 million years ago is extraordinary, Aurelio told Reuters. It's an indescribable feeling. The research was led by Brazilian scientist Rodrigo Tempmuller, a paleontologist. His findings recently appeared in an article in the publication Gondwana Research. Mueller said, "The most important part of this finding is its age. Because it's so old, it gives us clues as to how dinosaurs came to be." Mueller added that when Aurelio gave researchers the remains, they were covered by a thick layer of rock. At first, only parts of the backbone could be seen. Gondwanax means Lord of Gondwana. The name suggests the Gondwana landmass in the southern area of the supercontinent Pangaea. Pangaea later broke apart into continents. The name Paraisensis honors the town of Paraíso do Sul. I'm John Russell.
SpaceX has successfully completed a fifth test of its Starship rocket system. The uncrewed test was carried out Sunday at the American Space Company's Launch Center in Boca Chica, Texas. During the flight, the 121-meter-tall Starship was successfully pushed into space by a SpaceX Super Heavy booster rocket. after reaching a height or altitude of about 70 kilometers, the booster separated from Starship's second stage, or top half, as planned. The reusable booster was then directed by ground controllers to return to the launch center. Before touching down on the landing pad, the rocket relit three of its 33 Raptor engines in order to slow the booster for a controlled landing. The Super Heavy then positioned itself to land. For the first time, the booster was caught and secured in place by a huge structure that includes large metal arms. Video of the landing provided by SpaceX showed the booster rocket being captured by the structure exactly as planned. A short time later, Starship's second stage safely splashed down in the Indian Ocean. The test flight and successful landings demonstrated progress for SpaceX's Starship system. The American space agency NASA is planning to use Starship to carry the next U.S. astronauts to the moon. Such a landing would be the first since NASA's Apollo 17 mission in 1972. The next planned moon landing, which NASA officials have set for September 2026, is part of NASA's Artemis program. Artemis will also seek to establish a permanent base around the moon to support ongoing lunar visits and possible future trips to Mars. SpaceX was chosen to lead NASA's planned moon landing after numerous successful demonstrations and missions in recent years. The company's rockets and spacecraft have been dependably transporting astronauts and materials to the International Space Station, ISS, since 2020. NASA also chose American aerospace company Boeing to serve as a possible partner in its Artemis program. But the company's Starliner rocket has faced major delays and difficulties during past test flights. In the last one, Starliner successfully transported two American astronauts, Butch Wilmore and Sonny Williams, to the ISS in early June. The two were expected to stay in space for only a week. But ongoing technical issues with the Starliner spacecraft prevented a return trip. NASA recently decided to have Starliner return to Earth without the astronauts. The plan is for Wilmore and Williams to return home from the ISS in February on a SpaceX Dragon spacecraft. Before SpaceX's latest mission, several Starship rockets exploded during the test flights. The last non-exploding test happened in June. During that flight, SpaceX reported some damage to heat-resisting tiles on the outside of Starship. But improvements made since then appeared to have succeeded. After Sunday's flight, SpaceX chief Elon Musk said the rockets appeared to be generally in good condition with just minor warping of some outer engine parts from intense heat. He noted that those parts could be fixed easily. Musk is also chief of the social media service X. On the service, he expressed excitement when the Starship booster rocket returned to the launch area and was caught by the structure. SpaceX calls the huge metal arms that capture and secure the booster rocket on land chopsticks because they move similarly to the eating instruments. "The tower has caught the rocket," Musk wrote in a message on X. "Big step towards making life multiplanetary was made today," he added. The successful test flight was also praised on X by NASA Administrator Bill Nelson. "Congratulations to SpaceX on its successful booster catch and fifth Starship flight test today," Nelson wrote. He added that continued testing will prepare NASA and its partners for a series of bold missions to come in the future. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn joins me now to talk more about his technology report. Thank you for being here, Bryan.
Of course, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
This week, you reported on a recent flight test involving SpaceX Starship rocket. Let's take a look at some of the vocabulary words that were in the report that may be new to English learners.
Okay, sure. How about starting with the term booster? In the report, this word is used as a noun to describe the actual rocket that carried the Starship to space. The actual name for the rocket is Super Heavy, which describes its massive size and power. When used like this, booster means the engine and/or rocket that provides extra power to a spacecraft during the first part of flight.
And the root word for booster is boost. What can you tell us about how this word is used?
Yes, so boost can be used as either a verb or a noun. When used as a verb, it means to increase or improve something. An example of this would be if you were taking part in a sport and received support of some kind, you could say, "This help boosted your performance." And when used as a noun, you could say, "A boost of energy helped lead to a winning performance."
Another word we heard was bold, which is used as an adjective to describe future space missions.
Yes, this one seems like a good one to discuss since it is used quite regularly. As you mentioned, Ashley, this word was used by the chief of NASA to reference future missions planned by the space agency. In this sense, bold describes taking great risks to do something without being fearful to do so. A bold action is also very noticeable and often involves a major activity. Now, bold can also describe certain designs, colors, or shapes that appear strong or stand out. And this term is also used to describe words that are printed in bold letters on paper, signs, etc., that appear darker and thicker than the others.
All right. Thanks again for joining me, Bryan, and thank you for that report.
You're welcome. Thank you, Ashley.
My name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. You're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In Lesson 37 of the series, Anna finds a backpack outside her office building and tries to find the person it belongs to. Let's listen.
You know, I am from the country, and sometimes I miss it. But I really like life in the city. I love the city. Oh, look, someone lost a bag. Maybe it's theirs. Excuse me, is this bag yours?
No, it's not mine. It might be hers.
Thank you. Excuse me, is this bag yours?
No, it's not mine. It might be his.
Thank you. Hello, is this bag yours?
Yes, that's mine. These are all my travel things. Thank you. Thank you.
Luckily for this traveler, Anna found his bag and brought it to him.
Anna was thinking to herself,
I wonder whose bag this is.
That's whose, spelled W-H-O-S-E, which refers to possession. That means to whom the object or idea belongs.
Right. So if you find something and you're not sure whose it is, one thing you can ask is,
whose is this?
Remember that this word, whose, is spelled differently than the contraction of the two words, who is. Those two words form a subject and verb, like this.
Who's the president of the United States?
The contraction and the possessive adjective both sound the same. They are both pronounced with the sound of the letter Z at the end.
Whose bag is this? Who's the president of the United States?
And when we talk about to whom something belongs, we use possessive pronouns. We heard these when Anna was trying to find out whose bag she found.
Oh, look! Someone lost a bag! Maybe it's theirs. Excuse me, is this bag yours?
No, it's not mine. It might be hers.
Thank you. Excuse me, is this bag yours?
No, it's not mine. It might be his.
Thank you. Hello, is this bag yours?
Yes, that's mine. These are all my travel things. Thank you. Thank you.
You'll notice that these possessive pronouns sound almost the same as possessive adjectives. For example, the adjective form of the pronoun you is your.
Like when we say, this is your bag.
And then for the possessive pronoun, we just add the letter S. For example,
this bag is yours.
But notice that the S at the end sounds like the letter Z. Z.
Yours.
If you listen carefully, you can hear a bit of the sound of the letter S at the end of a word like yours. So the sound of Z is not as strong or as long as in a word like zero. Instead, it's more like a Z with a little S at the end. Yours.
Now listen to these five possessive pronouns.
Yours. His. Hers, ours, theirs. We'll listen to a chant at the end of today's lesson of the day to give you a fun way to practice saying these possessive pronouns.
Oh, we will. Whose idea was that?
That idea was mine.
Well, I'm not surprised. Let's go back to lesson 37 and see what the owner of the bag and Anna talk about.
Are you okay? You seem nervous.
Well, this is my first visit to Washington, D.C. I'm from a small town in the country. I feel a little lost.
I'm from the country, too. And I understand. When I first came here, I felt lost all the time.
So, do you like living in the country or in the city?
I like to live in the city.
Why?
The city is exciting. It has more culture than the country. There are many museums and restaurants. Every night, there's theater and music. And there are more jobs. That is why I'm here.
Well, I agree. There is more culture in the city, and there might be more jobs, but the country has more nature. It's peaceful and beautiful. There are more trees and mountains. The air is clean. You can go hiking and camping. The city is not beautiful. It's noisy and dirty.
I disagree. I think all the different buildings are beautiful. And I like to watch all the different people.
Anna and the man from the country.
And we should note that when the man uses the word country, he means he is from a rural area, not a city. It does not mean he's from a foreign country.
Good point. Anna and the man from the country are talking about which kind of place they prefer.
Prefer is a verb. It means to like something more compared to another thing. Anna prefers the city, while the man prefers the country.
So they are talking about their preferences.
Preference is a noun. It means the thing or the choice that you like more. And we can use it or the verb form to form a question. For example, we can ask,
which do you prefer, the city or the country?
Or if you already know or have mentioned the choices, you can just ask,
do you have a preference?
Or you can ask,
do you have a preference between the two?
Anna and the man prefer different things. In another lesson of the day, we'll listen to more of Lesson 37 of Let's Learn English and find out if Anna and the man continue to disagree or if they share some preferences.
And here's a question for our listeners. Do you have a preference between living in the city or the country? You can let us know which you prefer by writing to us at learningenglish@voanews.com. So, Andrew, we're almost out of time. How about we listen to that chant with possessive pronouns?
Okay, let's do it. And special thanks to my friend Jennifer, who helped record the chant. Here it is.
Whose is this?
Whose is that?
It's his.
It's hers.
It's theirs.
It's mine.
Whose are these?
Whose are those?
They're his.
They're hers.
They're ours.
They're mine.
Is it ours?
Is it his?
Is it hers?
Is it theirs?
It's not his.
And it's not hers.
And it's not ours.
And it's not theirs.
I think it's mine.
I think it's mine.
It's mine.
It's mine.
It's mine.
It's mine.
Is everything yours?
Not everything's mine.
This one's yours.
And that one's hers.
And those are his.
But what about these?
These are mine.
But what about those?
Those are mine.
Are you gonna share?
Of course I'll share.
Whenever we share.
It's not just yours.
It's not just mine.
It's yours and mine.
It's yours and mine.
It's yours and mine.
It's yours and mine.
And together it's ours.
I like the ending of that chant. It can feel good to share with others.
And if you enjoy the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast, we hope you will share it with other people. You can do that by finding us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram.
And you can find all of the Let's Learn English series on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.